Last week we were off because of the Labor Day holiday, and hopefully you had a great Labor Day. But last Tuesday, the Critical Areas Commission asked for a judicial review of a decision by the St. Mary's County Board of Appeals regarding swimming pools and the 100-foot buffer. Now, our rules in St. Mary's County prior to last year were always to deny anyone asking for an application to put a pool in the 100-foot buffer. We all are very sensitive to the health of the bay and our rivers, and we don't want to do anything that inflicts upon that. So with that said, we've always had a rule that said you cannot do anything within 100 feet of the water. So what happened, though, is that we were told, well, we can't stop people from asking for a variance. So I was on the Critical Areas Commission at the time. My term ended June 30th of this year. They have not reappointed another representative from St. Mary's County. So what concerns me is St. Mary's County is not represented on the Critical Areas Commission, and we have over 400 miles of critical area in our county. It's important we're represented. So what happened last week, some people have lots in Golden Beach that are very small, and they own, the particular people own three in a row, and they're all small. So what they wanted to do is put a swimming pool on a lot next to their home. Now, they're allowed to build a house, but they're not allowed to build a swimming pool. So what happened in their particular case, they're involved in an automobile accident. The wife suffered a broken heel, broken foot, a knee injury, the husband a pelvis injury, a leg injury, and they found aquatherapy to be working for them and helps them with their rehabilitation. So they have the wherewithal to build a pool, and they want to do so. They do not intend to build a house. They just intend to build a pool. Well, Critical Area Commission said no. Well, our Board of Appeals said, okay, you can do it. Given your circumstances, we think you should be able to do with your property what you want to do. So we had to go to court last Tuesday. And the judge in the case said, ruled in favor of the Board of Appeals. From this commissioner's perspective, it was a win for the people. It was a win against government regulation that doesn't make sense. Here you had people who had a medical injury, medical condition, that this was helping. That's what we're about, helping people. And the critical area was taking, the commission was taking the, and again, when I say Critical Area Commission, I was on that commission, and I was a commissioner. But we never saw these types of cases. This was all about staff. And I'm not condemning staff. I just think sometimes they live in an ivory tower, and they don't like anybody telling them what to do or asking them to justify something. And back when we were going through that variance procedure, I asked that attorney general who was here the other day for that case, what would be the factors that you would allow an approval of one? She said, Commissioner, I cannot tell you of any. We're going to deny every single one, and we're going to take them basis by case by case. Okay, okay, but just give me some idea. So if people come and want to go through this process, and here's my point, the process is expensive. To go through the Board of Appeals, you pay a fee. Usually you hire a lawyer. Usually you hire an engineer. You have to go through the time it takes to go to the meetings and all these types of things. And it's not unusual to spend thousands of dollars going through this process. Now, they had to pay a lawyer the other day to be in court. And I don't know what the Critical Areas Commission will do. I've asked, and I'll ask the commissioners, whether I can do it now or later, that we write a letter to the Critical Areas Commission, because the rules say that if you have not approved a representative to replace your representative when that term expires, that person will stay in that position until the new representative is appointed. So during the case, during a recess, I walked over to the critical area people who I know well, and I said, who's representing St. Mary's County on the Critical Areas Committee? Nobody. Well, that's not fair. Well, take it up with the appointment secretary for the governor. because your term's over, Commissioner, and St. Mary's County doesn't have anybody. So I would like to say, Commissioner President, that we write a letter to the appointment secretary asking for representation. Now,
I'll pass it on.
All right. Well, do we have consensus on that?
You agree?
Yes. Oh, yeah, agree.
We should. Absolutely.
Agree.
We should. Because what we have another swimming pool case coming up. Does it have the same merit? Probably not. Will it have the same result? I don't know. But we also heard about what's going on with Snow Hill Park today. And that would be another case that would come before the Critical Area Commission, the full commission, for a vote on how to approve. I never saw it. I never saw anything while I was there. So to say it was approved, I'm surprised. Maybe, I'm sure it was. I mean, I'm not questioning it, but it just didn't make sense. So enough of Critical Area Commission, but the people won one. Also, this past week on Thursday, the YMCA Capital Campaign Committee had their first meeting of their steering committee. 15 people showed up. It was a great meeting. Good start was had. They expect to have a bigger meeting in October. But this YMCA is going to be built, and I'm very encouraged by it. And I'm very encouraged by the people who have come along to help. I don't want to name names because I'll forget somebody, but I am encouraged by it. Next, I want to talk about a man named Tom Watts. People may know him, people may not. I first met him a little over 50 years ago when he first moved to St. Mary's County. He had married the daughter of a local banker named Jack Doherty. He was the president of Maryland Bank and Trust at the time. Tom Watts was a developer, a businessman, owned Riley Watts Insurance in Route 235. In his earlier days, in his late 20s, he was Captain Tom of Captain Tom's Ore House, if anybody remembers that from way back when in Park Hall. But he was a great guy. And he had he owned the Willis Rec Center, which we negotiated with just a few months ago. He wasn't in good health then. But what was interesting about him, he started out at $5.7 million for that facility. And he finally got down and we bought it for $4,250,000. It was quite a reduction. And part of his reasoning was, we want to do something good for the county. The county's been good to us, he and his wife and his brother-in-law and his sister-in-law. And he said, you know, we want to do something good. So he came down to that price and we were able to do it. So rest in peace, Tom Watts. My last thing I want to talk about is 911. Look, many of us know where we were that day, but I heard something interesting on the radio yesterday by a young lady who was the DJ. And what she said was, you know, many people know where we were. I know exactly where I was. But she said to people who are 30 or under, they don't really know. When I think about my grandchildren, and let's say kids in high school these days and younger and even college, they may not have been born 23 years ago or 22 years ago, however long ago it was. Or maybe they were infants or children so young they didn't realize the significance of it. And the point of that DJ was, get with these young people and tell them about it. Tell them what happened and what an impact it was on this country, and that it's something that needs to be remembered. Thank you.